Vilkām trīs, vēl dēm divas skrievietas ar agutījām vilkām un skatījām. Šausmīgs sniegs bija par upi vilkām. Bet attiešam, ka mandēliņu vilk, tad tos sargi bija noņemt. Tā jau viss, kas mira. Bērns, nu bērns glabāja pie privātajiem. Tos neskaitīja, ka tie ir apcietināti, tos pie privāti. Mums jau rakpuro. Un tad viens atkal bērnīši nomira. Tad es neatceros, cik lai bija pusgads vai gads bija. Tad es atkal vilku to. Un tad es tikko aizbrāju pie savu dēlu. Un tā bija pēdīga reize. Vienreiz es apciemu.
The Allies defeated Hitler. This horrible film footage was shown in the West, a Nazi concentration camp after liberation. But only a few understood what they were actually seeing. The site was being cleared for new inmates. The Soviets did not destroy the Nazi camps. They continued to use them after the war.
The agreement which Stalin made with the West affected the whole of Europe for the next 50 years. So although you can say the crimes are of the same order, the political outcome at the end of the Second World War quite clearly was very different for those two dictatorships.
And it was also very different for the people of Western and Eastern Europe.
The Soviet Union transferred a lot of ethnic Russians into the occupied Baltic countries. It was a clear violation of Geneva Convention, which forbids the transfer of civilians into the occupied countries. For example, in 1945, it was a case of my grandparents' family, which were forced by Soviet officers at the gunpoint out of their apartments. Afterwards, the Soviet officers settled there with their families.
The Kremlin strategically orchestrated ethnic cleansing in the Baltics so that the Russian settlers became a majority in all the largest Baltic cities. Estonians, Latvians and Lithuanians were loaded onto cattle trucks and deported to Siberia. The tiny Baltic nations were brought to the brink of extinction. Deportations, executions and torture became the post-war reality for millions of people. Concentration camps were scattered throughout both Europe and Siberia. In many of them, horrific medical experiments were performed on humans. In Butugichag camp in Magadan, the KGB used thousands of prisoners as guinea pigs, experimenting with the human brain. Many of these prisoners were still alive during the experiments. All of this happened after Nazism was defeated and memorials made to its victims. The victims of the Soviet death camps were buried in numbered graves. There is no memorial here. Just a pile of the shoes of murdered victims. Children's shoes among them. Feeling complete impunity, the post-war KGB terrorized the population, letting loose their most beastly instincts.
Mēs izgājām ārā, un tur pie verandas bija liela asins peļķe. Tās asins savācām stikla burkā, jo tā bija mūsu tēva dzīvība. Man ir grūti stāstīt, man tā kā uzplēsti ir jauna rēta un tā atkal asiņo.
This was drawn by a KGB prison guard who had served for 33 years in the Soviet interior system. He was depicting his routine, everyday life. Who were these men? Who were doing these atrocities? Meet one of them. The notorious Yanis Dzinters. A KGB interrogator in the Soviet-occupied Latvia, he was particularly famous for his brutality towards women. The victims' testimonies paint an horrific picture of his interrogations. Female victims were beaten and tortured by several KGB officers continuously for 20 hours. Not everyone could endure it. The wife of Ernest Waltman, Veronika, was beaten and tortured by Dzintars and his drunk colleagues for 4 days. She finally committed suicide by hanging herself in the prison cell. When the Soviet Union collapsed, Dzintars fled to Russia. The Kremlin refuses to extradite him, calling him an honorable veteran. With the hands of these KGB veterans, the Soviet Union terrorized and tortured innocent people. They were the ones who guarded death camps, where millions were exterminated and thousands used in horrific medical experiments. Many of these death camp veterans are still alive. Unlike their SS colleagues, they are proud of what they did. They are proud of the Soviet Union, which let them do it.
Прежде всего следует признать, и об этом я уже говорил, что крушение Советского Союза было крупнейшей геополитической катастрофой века. Крупнейшей геополитической катастрофой века.
Никому не хочется сознавать, что твои как бы предки были преступниками банальными. Я думаю, в этом дело.
I think that Russia, as a successor of the Soviet Union, is obliged to carry out a real investigation of all the crimes and the character of their system. And I think up to now, they are not ready and not able to do it.
Under Gorbachev and Yeltsin, the crimes of the Soviet Union were at least not advertised.
Under President Putin, we see a very different approach. The idea that Russia continues, in a sense, in the footsteps of the Soviet Union, and any attack on the Soviet Union is an attack on modern Russia.
The Russian identity has been shaped up by the sense of being parts of a big empire. When they lost the empire, they couldn't remain the same.
Вот эта ущербность, национальное унижение, то, что в Германии было после Первой мировой войны, а у нас после распада, это огромная питательная почва для вот этих вот новых нацистов, понимаете? Это как раз то, что было и дало всплеск в Германии к фашизму.
Со времен прихода Путина к власти, практически с конца 90-х годов, с началом Второй Чеченской войны, идет массовая ксенофобская пропаганда сверху. И у людей, в общем-то, появляется такая ненависть к инородцам, людям другого языка, другой веры, к другим странам.
Я депутат Государственной Думы, фракция ЛДПР, Куринович Николай Владимирович, член комитета по безопасности, хотел бы в своем лице приветствовать всех национал-патриотов России. Слава России!
The Nazi salute in the parliament of Russia. If you think it can't go any further, you would be wrong. Turning human tragedy into a farce has become a norm in Russia. The killers become heroes. Mass murderers are decorated veterans. Young people are taught that the crimes these people have committed against humanity are heroic deeds. It is no surprise that these crimes are replicated. The opportunity to condemn these crimes and to demand the extradition of those who committed them. Yet Europe hesitates. Why?
One knows what Europe, how we depend on Russian gas, petrol. So I think it's political. Not well. We know exactly why Europe. Cannot oppose Russia on so many issues.
Unfortunately, Europe continues ignore Soviet crimes, mass murders, while millions of the victims are neglected by Europe.
There is an equal right for all the victims to see those who committed crimes, to see them tried and sentenced.
But this is not how the world works. And for example, in the case of Katyn, it's now known very well the names and addresses of many of the Soviet officers who perpetrated those crimes, who shot people in cold blood. Yet if there was ever an investigation, those murderers should come to Great Britain because they'll be safe, because in this country it's not regarded as a war crime.
And the other Soviet crimes are not regarded as crimes either. Their victims are quietly passing away, receiving no comfort, no justice. In the European Union, that is reserved for other victims. Looking at this grey monument in the very center of Europe, one can't help thinking that it stands here because, deep in their hearts, many Europeans still believe in what these two men so persistently maintained. That when inferior nations are being killed, it cannot be seen as a crime, because it makes way for the more advanced nations to build a better life. While this idea is alive, and while the specter of these two men is haunting Europe, it will be very hard for its various nations to be truly united.